Okay, assalamu alaikum. I was asked about how to prepare teeth for overdentures. Okay. Suppose we have a canine, remaining canine, and we usually we do overdentures over canines. Sometimes you have the case where a premolar is present, a second premolar might be unilaterally, while you have another canine on the other side. But usually overdentures we do them when we have two canines present. Okay. So a canine and a premolar is okay. The tooth number five present, usually the tooth number five, I'll take an x-ray and see the grade of mobility of it. If it has good root structure, I would leave it, because you know that the lower five is the weakest in terms of root morphology.
Yes.
And the upper five is also the weakest in the upper arch. So the root morphology with a lot of resorption, usually we don't leave that tooth. We want something to take support from. This is the idea of overdentures anyway. Okay, so how do we prepare the tooth? The idea that I want is that I need to utilize the presence of the tooth in the bone. What will happen if the tooth is present in the bone? We know that the tooth are embedded, teeth are embedded inside the alveolar bone. So this is called alveolar bone. Okay, the bone around. And then we have periodontal ligaments, and then we have the soft tissue after that. Okay. So this embedding of the tooth inside this periodontal space with the periodontal ligaments, the bone, alveolar bone attached to it, and the soft tissue will maintain this bone high. Okay? So if we lose the tooth, this alveolar bone becomes resorption. And like disuse atrophy of muscles, also we have a disuse of bone causing resorption. If we lose the functional part, the pulling part of the bone, where the pull and push is present, these stresses created by the tooth movement and conducted to the, these movements are conducted to the bone, that cause the bone to keep and stay in place. If we lose this stimuli from the teeth, the alveolar bone is lost. We also get a benefit. So we're first of all getting the benefit of the support of the bone. We leave the bone there. The second support we're getting is from the tooth itself. The canines, lower canines, are usually very strong, and they have long roots inside, and we could benefit from them. So these are the teeth we usually use, okay? But the problem with overdentures is that we need to reduce their length, because we don't want it to interfere with the denture, because overdenture means we're placing all teeth. It's the idea of support beneath it that we're going to do. If the, I leave the canine in full anatomical contour, it becomes a partial. It's no longer a complete denture. Okay, so I need to place a canine, a prosthetic canine, be above this canine that's embedded beneath the denture. So I need enough occlusal space. To create this enough occlusal space, I need to measure the freeway space for the patient and see, do I have enough interarch space or not? The idea about interarch space will allow me to decide how much tooth ferrule I'm going to leave, because we're going to do elective cutting of this tooth. So the tooth usually is in full contour, okay? This tooth is usually in full contour. This is a full contour tooth. But I need to place a denture and place a tooth over it, so I need to place and be aesthetic in terms of the gingival line, if especially if the patient has a very low lip position, okay? Now, that necessitates that I'm going to cut this. How much do I cut it? Depending on how much space is left and the interarch space. So, if I could leave more, I leave more. I could leave up to 5-6 millimeters if I have good interarch space. But the idea many times is that these are also over-erupted, encroaching on the interarch space, so we don't have a space to leave not enough length. We don't have space here to leave this length of tooth. So we go to the minimum, okay? Uh-huh. The minimum amount of canine that I could leave is the amount of ferrule. What is the least amount of ferrule?
1 millimeter.
2 millimeter. No, 2 millimeter. I want ferrule, in fact. Minimum. You could go for 1 millimeter, but you no longer get resistance from it. Because if I leave, the more I leave from the canine beneath the denture, the more I'm getting lateral resistance. Uh-huh. The more I go low, I could even make it zero. With the level of the gingiva, I could do that. But the idea is I don't have any resistance now. I'm getting the resistance from the alveolar ridge, not from the tooth. If I'm going to leave 2 millimeters, I'm going to take some resistance from the tooth. So you have the options. The idea is at the end, do I have space to place my acrylic and an artificial tooth within this freeway space? Okay. So this elective cutting of the tooth structure, that means I'm encroaching on the pulp chamber. Sir? So that means I need to do endodontic treatment. So it's an, it becomes obligatory here. So this is why we do elective endo. The tooth might be vital, but still I do elective endo in cases of overdenture. Okay. Then I'm going to also do a finish line all around. Okay, this finish line. Because we do the caps with alloys, we just do a 0.5 finish line, chamfer all around. Okay. Why do we need to place metal over this and cap it? Many people will tell me, okay, doctor, let me just do the endo and place a composite cap and that's it. But the problem is teeth exposed to the oral cavity, especially in the canine area, are prone to caries. So you might have a caries attack. Okay, so they will rotten beneath the denture. They will not tolerate the microbiology beneath the denture. This is why we need to place a metal cap. So it's like a cap. It's only a preparation of chamfer preparation. So we have lost all of this now. Okay, we're now concentrating on the tooth itself, the remaining of the tooth. This is the part we're leaving. 1 millimeter, 2 millimeter, the more you leave, I told you, the more resistance you'll get, lateral resistance. And then we prepare a chamfer, we put the retraction cords, and we take impressions. This will come back as a cap. But the problem with the cap, if you take the 1 millimeter and less, you will not have anything to bond to. You don't have a core to bond to. So that necessitates that I place a post. Is it a conventional post, a full-length post to the 2/3 of the root length or up to 5 millimeters leaving? No, you don't need that much. You only need enough to resist the upper part. So this is now the clinical crown. The remaining tooth structure is the clinical crown. From there, I measure down the same length, at least. I could make it a bit longer, and that's it. So whatever I have as a clinical crown vertically, I need depth inside as a post. So it's a mini post, not a regular post. So I place a post space, I prepare my post space, I prepare my finish lines, I take impressions, and the lab will come back with a cap that I fit in, and I cement it with a post inside the root canal space. Any other question about the overdentures? So the teeth are canines, first of all. You could add a canine and premolar besides it. And this, in many cases, we have it. And why do we cut the teeth? Because the teeth are encroaching on the interarch space, and I need to place a full denture over it. Okay. Unilateral. Okay. Can you do a unilateral overdenture? You can. The idea is that you can. But what is the problem of the denture? The survival rate. There will be a huge rocking effect. If you don't have the other canine on the other side to stabilize the denture, this will be a fulcrum point. Where denture material, we know it's a bit flexible. It flexes during function. So this is a strong fulcrum point, and dentures flex around it. What will happen? The denture will keep breaking in that point. You can do it, you can. Unilateral overdenture, you can do it. But the problem is the flexure and the fracture. The survival of the denture over single abutments in overdentures is not enough. And this is why also on implants, you don't place a unilateral implant. You have to have on both sides. You're placing two or four or whatever number you're placing them in parallel to get the cross arch stability and the cross arch strength. And once more, the other thing with overdentures, because you talked about, so we have this complete denture or lower complete denture over these teeth, and these also are stress points, even when they're double.